In this series of videos, we're going to learn all about integrating using the method of partial fractions. So in this first video, all I want to do is tell you what this is about, what our goals are, and give you a first example or two. Okay, so what is partial fractions all about? Well, one of the first integrals we learned was how to integrate a polynomial function, something like the integral of x dx, or the integral of x squared plus 1 dx, or the integral of any polynomial, x to the 7th plus 5x to the 4th plus 11x squared minus 213 dx. We know how to integrate polynomials, and we've been using the fact that we know those integrals to compute all different sorts of integrals. So what we want to do in this series of videos is learn how to integrate rational functions. And what is a rational function? It's a ratio of two polynomial functions. Here's an example. Let's take 1. That's a polynomial. It's not a very interesting one, but it's a polynomial. And in the denominator, we'll have x squared minus x. That's also a polynomial. So what is this integral? Well, I don't know. One idea would be to set u equal to the denominator, but then du is equal to 2x minus 1 dx, and there's a 1 dx, but there's no 2x dx anywhere, and it's not easy to write 2x in terms of u. So we need a new idea to compute an integral like this one. So in this example, we are saved by the following fact. You can rewrite this rational function. Well, first, just notice that the denominator factors as a product of x times x minus 1. And in fact, the denominator is equal to 1 over x minus 1, one of these two factors, minus 1 over x. I mean, how do you check that that's true? If you put these over a common denominator, this would be 1 over x minus 1 times x over x minus 1 over x times x minus 1 over x minus 1. And then you can see that that gives you 1 over x times x minus 1. So this was okay, what I said right here. So what does that mean? So that means that the integral of 1 over x squared minus x dx is equal to, well, this function is equal to this function. So it's equal to the integral of 1 over x minus 1 minus 1 over x dx. This integral of a difference is a difference of integrals. So this is the integral of 1 over x minus 1 dx minus the integral of 1 over x dx. The integral of 1 over x, we know, is natural log of absolute value of x. For the same reason, the integral of 1 over x minus 1 is natural log of absolute value of x minus 1. Why is that true? You can check that that's true using a u substitution where u equals x minus 1. But this is something that we've been doing for a little while now, so I'm going to skip that set of details and just say that this is the natural log of absolute value of x minus 1 minus the natural log of absolute value of x plus c. You could rewrite this using properties of logarithms as the natural log of absolute value of x minus 1 divided by x, but this is fine too. Okay, so the question is, what is going to happen in more general examples? Like, the only reason that we were able to figure out this integral of this rational function is that we had a nice way of writing it as 1 over something minus 1 over something else, where each of those some things was x minus a number, x minus 1, x minus 0. So I'm going to pause and erase, and then we'll do one more example in this video. For our next example, let's do the integral of 2x minus 3 over x squared minus 5x plus 6 dx. So if you set u equal to the denominator, then du will be 2x minus 5 dx. And we have a 2x minus 3 dx. Those seem like they're close, but this is not easy to do by u substitution. I wouldn't know what to do from there. So before I show you what to do, let me just make a definition that we're going to use to talk about different kinds of rational functions throughout the rest of this section. A rational function is a ratio of two polynomial functions. So a rational function we can write as p of x divided by q of x, where these are both polynomials. And this is called proper if the degree of the polynomial p is less than the degree of the polynomial q. So in the first few videos, we'll just talk about how to integrate proper rational functions. And in the last video, we'll come back and we'll talk a little more about what extra thing you have to do if your rational function is not proper. Okay, so let's look at this example. The first thing to do when you're integrating a rational function is check if it's proper. Well, the degree of the numerator, 2x minus 3, equals 1, which is less than the degree of the denominator, x squared minus 5x plus 6, which is 2. So yes, proper. For now, what we're going to do with that information is just move on. When you encounter a rational function that's not proper, your next step is to stop and somehow turn it into something that is proper plus something else. Okay, so the next step in the process is to factor the denominator. Well, in this case, our denominator is x squared minus 5x plus 6. And I'll say that many students think of this section on partial fractions as one of the hardest parts of the course, not so much because all of the math 2B ideas are new, but because it requires you to be comfortable with high school algebra. So I know that you learn high school algebra in high school, but then if you don't use it for a while, there are some algebraic things that might kind of fade a little bit. So things like factoring polynomials. If you're going to factor this, you have to have x minus something times x minus something else. Why do I know that? Because the leading term is x squared. X minus a times x minus b. A plus b is 5, and a times b is 6. And there's only one way to do this. You can factor as x minus 2 times x minus 3. If that explanation for how you get to this factorization felt a little fast, I would totally encourage you to review using some of the materials that are posted on the resources for Math 2A 2B website. Okay, so the idea, this is the main idea behind the method of partial fractions. So suppose we can find real numbers, A and B, such that the thing that we're trying to integrate, this function, 2x minus 3 over x minus 2 times x minus 3, is equal to some number A divided by x minus 2 plus some number B divided by x minus 3. What is this? This is called a partial fraction decomposition. Well, this is like what happened in our very first example. We wanted to integrate 1 divided by x squared minus x, or 1 divided by x minus 1 times x, and we rewrote it as 1 over x minus 1 minus 1 over x. The main idea behind the method of partial fractions is that if we can write our rational function this way, then we can compute the integral of the rational function by computing the integral of the first term, which we'll know is a times the integral of 1 over x minus 2 plus the integral of the second term, which will be b times the integral of 1 over x minus 3. Integrating each piece is easier than integrating what you started with. So the name of the game becomes, how do you find a way of writing your rational function using this partial fraction decomposition? So I'm going to pause. I'll tell you the answer in this case. We'll compute the rest of the integral, and then I'll come back and I'll tell you how I found a and b. Our goal is to integrate 2x minus 3 over x squared minus 5x plus 6, which we have factored as x minus 2 times x minus 3. We were just saying that the method of partial fractions, the idea is to rewrite your rational function using a partial fraction decomposition. That is, we want to find real numbers a and b so that 2x minus 3 over x minus 2, x minus 3 is equal to a over x minus 2 plus b over x minus 3. I claim that a equals minus 1 and b equals 3. So I'm not going to explain where that came from for a couple of minutes, but once you have this decomposition, you can check, because you can put these fractions over a common denominator and see that this is negative 1 over x minus 2 times x minus 3 over x minus 3 plus 3 over x minus 3, x minus 2 over x minus 2. So we have a common denominator, and the numerator is now minus 1 times x minus 3 plus 3 x minus 2. So we get minus x plus 3 plus 3 x minus 6 over x minus 2 x minus 3. And what do you know? That is 2x minus 3 over x minus 2 x minus 3. So it's harder to find this decomposition than to check whether your decomposition is correct. Like if someone hands you an A and B and says, is this a partial fraction decomposition? That's easy to check. You put everything over a common denominator and you just compare the numerators. Okay, so now that we know this fact that we can rewrite our rational function this way, we know that the integral of 2x minus 3 over x minus 2, x minus 3, dx equals the integral of minus 1 over x minus 2 plus 3 over x minus 3 dx. We'll take this sum of two functions and rewrite it as the sum of the integrals. So we get minus 1 times the integral of 1 over x minus 2 dx plus 3 times the integral of 1 over x minus 3 dx, and this is negative natural log absolute value x minus 2 plus 3 natural log absolute value of x minus 3 plus c. And again, you can rewrite this a little bit using logarithm rules, but you certainly don't have to. All right, so that is the integral of the rational function that we started with. Let me note that the final form of the integral is a little complicated. So there's not going to be any really easy way to do this integral. You have to put in some work at some point. All right, so what did we skip? We skipped how to find A and B. So I'm going to pause and erase, and I'll explain that very last piece of this problem. The only part of this problem that we haven't solved so far is we want to explain how to find a partial fraction decomposition of the rational function on the left. That is, we're looking for real numbers a and b so that 2x minus 3 over x minus 2 times x minus 3 equals a over x minus 2 plus b over x minus 3. And the main idea is just to put everything over a common denominator. So we have a over x minus 2 times x minus 3 over x minus 3 plus b over x minus 3 times x minus 2 over x minus 2. Let's write the numerator all together. So we have a x minus 3 plus b x minus 2 divided by x minus 2, x minus 3. So what does this mean? 2x minus 3 over x minus 2, x minus 3 equals a x minus 3 plus b x minus 2 over x minus 2, x minus 3. These are both rational functions. The denominators are equal, so the numerators also have to be equal. So this is a key idea here. Because this tells us that 2x minus 3 equals ax minus 3 plus bx minus 2. What we'll do now is expand the right-hand side and put the x parts together and the no x parts together. So you can write this as ax minus 3a plus bx minus 2b, or putting the x parts together, this is a plus b times x plus minus 3a minus 2b. So both expressions are something times x plus something else. So for these things to be equal, the x coefficients, meaning the number multiplying the x, must be equal. And the rest of the expression, the part with no x, the constant coefficient, if you like, just the part with no x, coefficients, must also be equal. So we took this one equation, 2x minus 3 equals a plus b times x plus negative 3a minus 2b, and we're getting two equations out of it. What I'm saying is 2 equals a plus b. On the left-hand side, the x coefficient is 2, and on the right-hand side, the x coefficient is a plus b. Our other equation is the no x part. The no x part on the left is minus 3, and the no x part on the right is minus 3a minus 2b. So how do you find real numbers a and b that make both of these equations true at the same time? This is something you probably talked about when you learned like high school algebra, but maybe haven't thought about it all since. This is kind of like what you have to do when you're trying to find the intersection points of two lines. So you have two equations and two variables. The way I like to think about this is if you add equal things to equal things, you get things that are still equal. So what we can do is add 2 times the first equation to the second equation. So what does that give us? Well, 2 times the left-hand side is 2 times 2. We're adding 4 to negative 3, and we'll get 1 equals 2 times the right-hand side is 2a plus 2b. 2a plus 2b plus minus 3a is minus 1a. Minus 2b plus 2b is 0. So 1 equals negative A. And if 1 equals negative A equals minus 1. So we now know that any solution for A and B that makes both of these equations true has to have A equals minus 1. But if A is equal minus 1, 2 equals minus 1 plus B. So we see that B must be equal to 3 to make the first equation true. And you can just check that with this choice of minus 1 and 3, the second equation is also true. Because now minus 3 equals minus 3 times minus 1, which is 3, minus 2 times 3, which is 6. 3 minus 6 is negative 3, and everything checks out. So if that felt a little fast at first, don't worry. We'll do more examples like this in the subsequent videos.